morning, everyone. First of all, I thank the organizers for inviting me for this session. My talk is on anterior cervical discectomy and fusion. I'll be talking primarily about the operative procedure. It's indicated in cervical disc herniations, OPLL, kyphosis correction, and cervical dislocations. It has great advantage in giving direct decompression. Also very good kyphosis correction and effective anterior release with minimum blood loss. But the disadvantages are that of less effective in multi-level disease, and it has its own approach related complications. So one has to know the anatomy of the cervical spine. Here you can see a cross section where anteriorly there are the strap muscles, esophagus, trachea, and then the longus coli and the vertebral body. There's also the carotid sheath on either sides. And uses the Smith-Robinson approach, where you use the intermuscular plane to go into the, to reach the vertebra. The omohyoid muscle comes in the way sometimes when you're exposing for the C6 or C7 vertebra, and that may have to be sacrificed, and that's not a big problem. There are also nerves. There is the sympathetic trunk as well as the stellate ganglion. Rarely even those can get injured. There's the fascia, which is a cervical fascia, the superficial as well as the deep cervical fascia. Now the superficial cervical fascia is the superficial part where the platysma is visible. The deep cervical fascia is divided into three layers. The superficial layer of the deep cervical fascia is the investing layer, which goes all around the muscles. The middle layer is that which holds the strap muscles as well as the pretracheal fascia. And then there is the deep cervical fascia, layer of the deep cervical fascia, which is on top of the vertebra. That is also known as the prevertebral fascia. One uses blunt dissection to reach up to the vertebra. If you use the intermuscular plane, it becomes very easy. One retracts the carotid sheath laterally and the medial structures of esophagus and trachea medially to reach the vertebra. There is also blood vessels there. The superior thyroid artery comes when you're exposing the superior upper vertebrae like C3, C4, and the superior thyroid artery can be ligated from the side where you are approaching. There's also the vertebral artery. Usually, we do not come across it in the anterior dissection. One should make sure that one doesn't go lateral to the uncovertebral joint, the uncinate process. One has to stay medial to the uncinate process while doing the discectomy. And then there is, here again, you can see the uncovertebral joint with the nerve root behind it and the vertebral artery foramen lateral to it. So this is the position where you can see that there is the neck is in neutral position. There is a small rolled sheet underneath the shoulder, and there are these straps to pull the shoulder down so that you get adequate exposure. The chin is also strapped so that the head doesn't move too much, and the head is on a head ring. In the leg, there is a bolster to keep the knee a little flexed, and there's also a stopper at the foot end so that the patient doesn't slide down while you're putting tension on the straps to pull down the shoulder. The Ryle's tube is put so that the esophagus feels like a cord, and it's easier to retract the esophagus. And after draping, one marks the thyroid cartilage as well as the cricoid cartilage, because these are the landmarks for knowing which level to decide on the incision. When you are identifying your levels. So the hyoid cartilage comes at C3 vertebra, is at the level of C3. The thyroid cartilage is at C4, C5, and the cricoid cartilage is at the C6 vertebral level. So here is the video for of the procedure. It's a transverse incision for a single level discectomy and fusion. After putting the incision, you dissect through the subcutaneous tissue, and then you hold on to the platysma, and with the fine scissors you nick the platysma, go underneath and dissect out the platysma. Then you'll come to the superficial layer of the deep fascia, deep cervical fascia, and using scissors you can separate out and go through the pretracheal fascia. use bipolar cautery for cauterizing the bleeders, and then you use a peanut to separate out the go through the pretracheal fascia. You use the Langenmex retractor to gently retract the medial structures more medially, and with your finger, with my left index finger, I'm usually pulling the protecting the carotid artery which is within the carotid sheath. Blunt dissection with my fingers takes me right down to the desired vertebra. Any vessel that comes in the way, small vessels are ligated. Here is a this is how it looks. That is the disc. You use a 90-90 angled needle, place it in the disc space, take an image intensifier shot, and then you you identify your level. Then you bring in the microscope and start the discectomy. Here, the discectomy is, once you have a bloodless field, it's pretty easy to do a discectomy. You can see on either side, sides, I have put the pins. Now these pins are inserted into the vertebrae so that the disc space can be opened up some more. Using a 2 mm upcutter, I'm nibbling taking bites on the inferior ledge that is from the superior vertebra, so that more space is created, and I also get some bone graft for putting within the cage. Then I use curettes to do the discectomy to remove the soft crab meat like disc, and use disc forceps to remove those loose fragments. I use the curette also to prepare the end plates. As I'm doing the discectomy, I also remove the cartilaginous end plate and expose the bony end plate. So it's important to expose the bony end plate so that you can create a nice bed for placing the graft and to facilitate infusion. So there you can see I'm going deeper into the interbody space anteriorly, and there I'm removing the cartilaginous end plate. And gradually proceeding towards the posterior annulus. There, nicely scrape off the end plates, and there you have it. It's pretty bloodless avascular structure. So you not to worry about the bleeding when in most of the substance of the disc. The bleeding can come in those corners on either sides where the epidural vessels are can be seen. There, once you reach the posterior part of the annulus, I would start distracting the pins so that the space increases, so that I improve my visual on the PLL. So there I'm distracting it so that I can see a little better. And then, yes, I will use the upcutter to nibble. I'll use a 1 mm upcutter to go beneath the posterior edge of the end plates, and to pull off the PLL or last remnants of the annulus from there. And once I'll use a probe, a blunt 90 degree angled probe to remove the last bits, and use a 1 mm upcutter to pull it off. Essentially use as small an upcutter as possible. This is in the cervical spine, there's no role in the posterior part of the discectomy. There is no role for larger sized upcutters. And there I'm using a 15 mm blade to put an incision on the posterior part of the annulus and the PLL if required, because at times one cannot slip the even the 1 mm upcutter underneath. So just put a probe and then to pull off the the PLL so that there is adequate decompression of the spinal cord. Here you will see gradually the spinal cord being exposed. If there are bleeders, one shouldn't hurry up. It's very important to stop even the smallest of bleeders because without a good visual of the field, one shouldn't attempt a discectomy or doing any kind of activity around the spinal cord, because cord cannot be handled directly, and we have to gently remove the structures which are sitting on the spine, on the dura. So here I'm using a sharp hook to lift up the PLL, and then using a 1 mm upcutter to incise it. And there you can see that there is very good decompression. You can see the sac there, that's the dura, and one can do a complete decompression going the entire width of the interbody space. So from there, then you prepare the end plates, the microscope will come off, and then we'll prepare the cage, and we'll take whatever graft is available, we'll place it in the interbody, within the space, and then go on to place it and see under image guidance. And that is how it looks, a well done fusion with a standalone cage with two screws. You can also use bone grafts for the same purpose, and also support it with a plate, or you can just use standalone cages or cages with plate, or you can just use standalone cages with just two screws or two or three screws in them. So closure is pretty simple. I use a 30 Vicryl and do continuous suturing of the platysma, as well as put subcuticular sutures in for skin. Complications are that of recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy and hoarseness of voice, dysphagia, esophageal perforation, and esophagocutaneous fistulas can be there. These are very rare. Nerve root injury, spinal cord injury, reperfusion injury can happen, vertebral artery injuries. So one has to learn the exposure very well. Once the exposure is learned, then it becomes pretty simple. Infection and blood loss, but blood loss is usually minimal. So it's important to do the surgery in reasonable time, because prolonged anesthesia is known to cause more complications and longer increased stay in hospital. And those are the ones where you need to go back to the operating room to solve some complications. Thank you very much.